Yeah. It looks like there's just one additional attendee so far, but oh no, there's three, so they're coming in. Julian is probably letting them in as they register, as they come in. Yeah, oh, there's more than five or six.
Are you ready, or?
I think you're ready whenever you want to start, Barbara.
Oh, you know, I don't know the time.
3:30.
All right, hi everybody.
I have a quick question for Peter before we start. What are the next two dates of our meetings?
I'll have to look it up. I'll let you know.
Get that. You want me to start? I'll start while you're looking at it. Sorry. I'll start. Welcome everybody to the November 4th, 2020 Portsmouth Conservation Commission meeting. Per New Hampshire RSA 91-A23B, the chair has declared COVID-19 outbreak an emergency and has waived the requirement that a quorum be physically present at the meeting pursuant to the governor's executive order 2020-04, section 8, as extended by executive order 2020-18, and emergency order number 12, section 3. Members will be participating remotely and will identify their location and any person present with them at that location. All votes will be by roll call. So if we want to start by identifying ourselves, Samantha?
Samantha Collins, I'm at home 820 Middle Road and my husband and daughter are downstairs.
Thank you. Jessica?
Jessica Blasco, I'm at home 74 Wentworth Road. My husband and kids are elsewhere in the house.
Thank you. Ted?
Ted Jankowski, 27 Franklin Street. My partner Claire is upstairs on the rowing machine, and my dog Arthur is in the other room.
Thank you. Allison?
Allison Tanner, 380 Greenleaf Avenue. I'm in my home office. My husband is elsewhere in the house, as is my dog, and my cat's on my bed.
Thank you. Chair Barbara McMillan is at home at 84 Hillside Drive, and I am alone in my office, and my husband is elsewhere in the house. And then we also have Peter and Jillian. I don't know if you want to, you don't need.
Yeah, sure. Peter Brooks, I'm in my office in City Hall by myself.
Okay. And Jillian, you're on?
I am here helping co-host.
Okay, great. Thank you. Okay. Did you find out the dates for the next meeting, Peter?
The next meeting is December 9th and I believe January 13th, but I'm not sure because we don't have the new meeting calendar, but that would be the appropriate, the logical date.
Thank you, Peter.
Yep.
Thanks, Peter. So the first item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes for October 14th, 2020. So anybody want to make, anybody have any comments, actually? Allison?
Yes, I on page 4, there's just a misspelling twice in the second paragraph. The word Lyme is spelled like Lyme disease instead of Lyme, the fertilizer that's used for lawns. It should be L-I-M-E instead of L-Y-M-E.
Great, thank you. Anybody else? There were a couple of words missing. I just had... on page 3, on the second actual paragraph, fourth line up from the bottom of that paragraph, it starts with management, needs the word is after that. And then same on page 7, first paragraph, Mr. Britz noted this application came here in June. That's it. Anything else look good to me? Anybody want to make a motion to approve?
I'll make a motion to accept the meeting minutes from October 14th with the corrections that were suggested.
Second that.
Second, Jess. Okay, roll call. All those in favor, Samantha?
Yes.
Jess?
Yes.
Ted?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. Thank you. Item two is the conditional use permit application number one, which is 140 Edmond Avenue. Is there anybody here to speak to that?
Hello, everybody. I'm Alex Ross. I don't know if everyone remembers this one. It's been going on for a long time. We were before you quite a while ago. And then we actually went to TAC, and there was some reconfiguration of the parking. So I discussed this with Peter, and that's why we're back before you. Probably the best sheet to look at is drawing three of our plan set.
Alex, do you want to share your screen, or do you want us to put that up there?
Yeah, if you could put that up, that would be best, if Jillian could.
Do you have that plan, Jillian?
I don't immediately, but I can go grab it.
Oh, okay. I didn't have it in front of me that time.
Well, I think, I'm sure everyone can look at the paper copy as well.
Essentially, we're looking at the landscaping plan. Is that the sheet that you wanted us on?
That's correct, right. So if you look at that landscaping plan, you can see parking spaces 1 through 6. And that's what we had before you last time. Now we've added spaces 10, 11, and 12. So you can see there's a slightly reconfiguration to get those spaces in. That those spaces will still be pervious pavers. We will have an infiltration trench around those spaces. And we're still planning on doing some wetland buffer plantings to the east of that parking area. And we're also planning on installing some boulders, because what's always happened in the past is that property line is not clearly marked out in the field, and the parking kind of spills over there. So we want a clear delineation that the parking lot stays on this parcel. So essentially those are the changes. This was brought on by TAC. They wanted us to narrow down the driveway. They wanted additional parking. We feel it will still provide a good area as a buffer prior to the wetlands. And the wetlands are actually across the street. So if we go to the next sheet, page 4, you can see kind of a zoomed out plan. So that this parking area is within the 100-foot buffer from the wetlands that are across the street. So we're improving the drainage in that area. Years ago, that used to be a paved parking lot. So we want to get in some good buffer plantings, improve the stormwater drainage, get some infiltration in there. And this will achieve all that. We're planning on going to planning board later this month. And I guess another thing, because of the late time of the year, these plantings would not be done until next year. Just wouldn't make sense to start anything right now. So I don't know if anyone had any questions from the previous setup to this, or comments they might want to go through.
Are there any questions, Allison?
Yeah, I was just wondering if you could remind me. So people are driving from Edmond Avenue directly into these parking spaces. Is that correct?
That's correct. Okay. Yes.
Any other questions? I had one question about you guys, where you're putting those new parking spaces, 10, 11, and 12, are you going to be cutting down any vegetation, trees, or anything to do that? Or because
that's actually a grassed area up there.
So that's no.
No.
Maintains the entire property? Do they have a lawn maintenance company or?
He does have a maintenance company. And as part of this work, I should have elaborated that a little bit. We have been working with a soil scientist, Mark Jacobs. And as part of this work, and we put notes to that effect on the plan, the planting there will be done with his direct supervision. We've outlined the wetland buffer planting types in the corner there in the northeast. And then also there's a clouded area that this was discussed at TAC. Mark Jacobs will provide the Conservation Commission a range or some options for planting in that area as well. So this will be supervised by a soil scientist.
So we had, Alex, we had two stipulations at the last ones, but I last time we saw this, which I think that one of the stipulations is that you would come back to us for more parking, which you're doing now. And then the other one was getting approval. And I think you mentioned from City Council on the plantings and that in the application, that's all set, right? Or going to be?
Yeah, so that's kind of a running condition of approval that any work that's done off the property would get authorization from City Council. So what I anticipate is we'll go to Planning Board. If we receive approval, that will be part of the condition, and will be heard by City Council to allow us to work in that area and put in those plantings.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments from the commissioners? Anybody like to make a motion? Allison?
I'll make a motion that we recommend approval for the conditional use permit at 140 Edmond Avenue.
Seconded? Jessica?
Second that.
Discussion?
Well, one of the things that we did at our last meeting, maybe for the first time, was to require that properties that are abutting the 100-foot wetland follow organic land management practices and the maintenance of their entire lot, Alex. And it's really not difficult. They have it's a group called the Northeast Organic Farmers Association. They're one of the oldest such groups in the country. And they set some really basic standards. And according to their standards, I would ask that the property be maintained in accordance with their standards. And I'm sure that Peter can send them to you, and they're really pretty, there's a lot of options. You just want to follow the preferred practices that are there.
Sure.
Would you be open to that?
Yeah, I'd have to run that by the owner, but it sounds like that would be fine.
Okay.
Any other just
make that a formal amendment to the motion.
Is the Allison and Jessica okay with that?
Yes.
Want to do a vote by ready for a vote? Samantha?
Yes.
Jessica?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Ted?
Yes.
And the chair votes yes. So I think the motion passes. That's it. Thanks, Alex.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks for your time.
Bye.
Bye. Thank you. So we'll move on to conditional use permit application, new business, 105 Bartlett Street, item number one. Is there anybody here to speak to that, Patrick? You are muted.
I'm muted.
You're muted.
Sorry about that.
Who else did you want to
do it by now? Sorry, Peter, what?
Did you have other people? It looks like Robbie and
Jeff. Robbie, Jeff.
John Pinciano. No, he's not there now. Just Robbie and Jeff, probably, for presentation.
Yeah, I believe that should be fine. I don't know. I guess I can defer to Jeff if he wants additional people. But we'll try to keep this small. So good afternoon, folks. Patrick Crimmins with Ty and Bond. Thanks for being here and to listen to us. We were last before you folks in June. You know, given everything that has been going on in the world today, there was a little bit of a pause in this project. But we're happy to be back before you and have this project hopefully moving forward. Just a little recap of the project. It's located at 105 Bartlett Street. I'm sure you're all familiar with the site, with Ricci Lumber, the Ricci Windows and Doors facility, the industrial space that's currently occupied by Great Rhythm and the Doggy Daycare, and what is now a vacant shop that was previously occupied by a marine contracting company. So just a step back from June, you know, this process actually started over a year ago. We actually met with you folks for a work session back in September of 2019, and a number of other boards and public meetings as well in the fall of 2019. At that time, we had a different plan. It included 272 dwelling units, I believe, and the buildings themselves were situated more so that they were pushed further up against the North Mill Pond. And we received a lot of good feedback from you folks and from abutters and the planning board and such. So we took that into consideration and came back with you with a revised plan back in June with what was a reduced density of at that time was 174 units. And we pulled the buildings back off of the North Mill Pond in response to some of that commentary. So Peter, can I share my screen? Is that a?
Yep.
Great. Great. So let's make sure. Can you all see that?
Yes.
Yes.
Great, thank you. All right, so that this is that existing site that I just described. So back in June, you know, we had some good dialogue with you folks and had a number of comments that we have since incorporated into the plan set. But just to kind of give you the quick overview here again, I know it's been a few months. We have that access drive that's coming off of Bartlett Street. This is a private road into a cul-de-sac. We have three proposed buildings. Building A and B are multifamily buildings. Building C is a mixed use building with office and amenities on the first floor and dwelling units located on the second through fourth floors. The project is going to be providing community space for an incentive to provide an additional floor. So there'll be four-story buildings here and here, and actually there is a zoning district line through the site, so it steps down to a two-story building. You'll see here, one of the things we did do though was, to break up some of this architecture, was step this building back. So this drops down from a first to the you'll see the second story when I get to the more detailed plan. This is a surface parking area underneath. We do have garage parking located under building B and building A. I mentioned the community space area. So we'll be providing what would be the first 50 feet of area would be deeded as community space to the city of Portsmouth. In this location here, this is what ultimately will allow for the construction of the North Mill Pond Trail along the North Mill Pond. In addition, we're providing more open area, a park that will come off of this trail in the rear of the buildings itself. Back when I'll go to the more detailed plans real quick. So again, this is just that drive. There have been no real changes here to the plan since we last saw you folks in June. In terms of this driveway, this is just the access. We are improving it. We're reducing buffer impact along it, providing pedestrian access where there isn't now, and cleaning up the parking and adding some green space. This is the development site. This is 4.71 acres right here. We have the cul-de-sac that's part of this private road. Again, I mentioned that these are the multifamily buildings. This line here is delineates that four-story. This steps down to the one-story. Again, this is like this steps down to two stories here. When we met with you folks, there was some comments about concerns with building and parking impacts in the buffer. So we took a look at that and came back to you with a plan that we think hopefully addresses those comments. Particularly one would be the parking, which previously had extended down beyond this Cabot Street view corridor. So we pulled that parking back over 100 feet. What we're going to do is utilize some shared parking off of the private road to meet our counts so that we can provide as little parking as we can, but still meeting the zoning ordinance. There is one small portion of pavement that still sits in this buffer area here, but that's required for fire truck turning. So the reason we have this, so what would fire trucks would come down and they have the ability to turn up here, and this would allow them to back out and pull out if they were to come up and utilize this fire lane here. So we've reduced that paved area significantly, pretty much pulling all parking in the development lot outside of the buffer area. The existing paved areas within the buffer area, which you're probably familiar with the site, go right up to the water's edge. So we're improving it here also by pulling those back as well. Are utilizing this existing paved parking area to put in the cul-de-sac. Another comment had with respect to impacts in the buffer were related to the buildings, specifically, building B and building C. So building C, you'll recall that we were, what we were doing was matching we were reusing the footprint of what the existing building is that currently houses the Great Rhythm and Doggy Daycare. But a portion of that existing building extended into zero to 50 foot buffer. So what we've done is we've notched the building out, pulled that out of the 50 foot buffer to address that comment. On building B, that previously extended out further to the 50 foot setback off of the water. We've also pulled that building back so that now it aligns, it's flush, it doesn't jut out past what this existing footprint is. So we've reduced the impact in the zero to 50 foot buffer there as well. just to kind of, I can show you real quick there. We did a very quick overlay just to kind of show the old versus the new. So the new is the green, which you can see what hasn't changed. And the old is the red. And I think what you can see here is in that red, the old, that's all that parking that we pulled back to this point. And then again, pulling back those buildings like we had, like I just mentioned. So that in terms of the site plan was some revisions that we did to the site itself. There was some comments with respect to stormwater. So I'll go to that sheet next. For the development area. So one of the comments that had come out of, it actually came out of both the Conservation Commission and Technical Advisory Committee was with respect to water temperature concerns with the direct discharge to the North Mill Pond. So what we've done, which was not part of the prior design, because it's tidal waters, you know, you can direct discharge into it as long as it's treated. But what we're doing here is rather than just direct discharging it, we are going to collect all the parking area runoff and detain it for a 24-hour period and slowly release it so that any temperature increase that may have occurred it'll have the ability to regulate and then get into the pond at a slow release rate so that the temperature has the ability to reduce. So there really wasn't. We looked in DES regulations and there wasn't a ton relating to cooling in the alteration of terrain regulations, but we actually went to the main DEP regulations for this just to try and find something that we could use. And that's what we based it on. The main DEP regulations have something in there with relation to treatment units and discharge. And if cooling was to be required, that it should be detained for up to 24 hours and slowly released. So that's what we are doing with this system to address the concerns with temperature related to the parking lot. So that was a change on this plan. There was a lot of discussion about, buffer impact calculations. I know with this parcel, there are, you know, there's five properties obviously that are involved in the project. So there was a lot of discussion around, you know, what we were counting as impact and it looked more so, I think we were adding it up more of a total. So what we did here, just to kind of really try to break it out and give you a visualization, is show the existing at the top, the proposed at the bottom, and what we've done is on this existing, we applied what is going to be the proposed property lines. So we're looking at an apples to apples comparison of land area versus buffer impact area in the existing condition versus proposed condition. And I won't go through the table in detail, I guess, but what you can see is overall, this is it's a net improvement for buffer impact total. Buffer impact improvement, it's almost 21,000 square feet. You can kind of see it, you know, broken down through we measured it from the 0 to 25, the 25 to 50, and the 50 to 100. And actually the only category that even shows any increase in here in the proposed condition is under the 25 foot to 50 foot. And that's about 1,000 square foot impact. But that impact is all related to the North Mill Pond Trail that will be installed as part of the city project. So removing that, the project itself, it's a total, there is no increase in any category here of buffer impact. So there was also discussion in terms of, you know, what we were counting, right? Some of the focus was on, you know, this roundhouse. So what we did, we had included in the package just to kind of give some visual evidence, like a photo log that showed, you know, the different areas of the site. I can go to that real quick. Kind of in terms of when you're looking at the buffer impact and existing condition, you know, I know a lot of people are probably pretty familiar with this, especially if you're going to Ricci Lumber or the Doggy Daycare or Great Rhythm at any point, but you can see with you know, all the pavement that's built right out to the water's edge, we are pulling that back and improving that. But particularly, I guess, in this area here as well, there were questions as to what we were counting as buffer impact. So, you know, we were taking surveyed lines and calculating the buffer impact. We weren't just, this wasn't just an assumption. We were using it based on these edge of gravel, edge of pavement, and, you know, these structure lines, especially like, for example, this roundhouse came into a lot of discussion. So I wanted to just kind of give some visual evidence. But if you walk out there, you can see this is, while it's dilapidated, falling down, sure, like the foundation's, you know, cracking and falling through, and there is some vegetation that's coming up through it. This is a structure. It still exists. There's walls that still exist up there. You can, here's like one example, but just the foundation itself is still all in place. So this in our minds is a structure. I guess what I would say to that, if there is still debate on it, even if we weren't to count this, we are still at a, you know, a net improvement of what would be about 17,000 square feet. So if there was any debate still as to this roundhouse, we are still improving, a net improvement over this. So I guess that kind of summarizes the buffer impacts. I hope the table was helpful, because there was just a lot of discussion about the numbers, and we really were trying to show graphically an apples to apples comparison, and that we are just truly trying to add up what we believe is impact based on surveyed lines. This isn't based on visual evidence. This is actually what's on the paper, and that we confirmed it in the field and tried to provide those photos to back it up. So that's a summary of the buffer impacts. I guess what I'd like to do now is another revision that had been incorporated into the plan set was related to the landscape plans. So I guess what I'll do is I'll put the landscape plans and let Robbie speak to those.
Sorry, I was muted. I didn't realize it. Peter, can we share my screen? Because then I can point to what I'm talking about a little more easily.
I'll stop sharing, Robbie.
Thank you. All right. I assume that you can see these now. So as Patrick reviewed in his presentation, that the building has changed over time. Is stepped away from the mill pond and back towards the back part of the site, which gave us a real opportunity to create this park space, which in my mind is sort of the bracket bookend to the other end of the proposed greenway. The proposed greenway has a public space down at the towards Market Street behind the AC Hotel. And then once you get on that trail, it's basically a single trail for quite a while. And then as you enter this site, because the building stepped back from the water, it allows the development of an open space here. That open space allows the trail to go along the edge of the mill pond, and has a almost like an eddy to me. That's what it seems like, is that, you know, you come along that space and there's that trail, and there's a space here between these buildings. It's the concept of that this space is that it's based on the roundhouse and the turntable that had been there and was, is there, and, you know, won't be there once the buildings go in. So we're doing a rain garden, which we need, that is shaped in a circle and recalls the roundhouse, and then having a deck-like bridge that goes over it to recall the turntable. As Patrick mentioned, there's parking under these buildings. They're slightly raised, but we're gently sloping the site up towards those buildings to create almost an amphitheater type feeling. There will be circular seat walls in that slope, and then along the face of the building, layered drifted planting that softens the building and provides a little bit of green along the residences that face out that way. So we've obviously put trees along the parking lots and did the drift planting along the the face of the building. We're leaving a lawn area. That lawn area will be done in a tri-fescue, tall fescue mix, which is a native mix that can withstand, has deeper roots and can withstand drought. It will have a tendency to brown out during the summer, but it's a native grass, and we think that that's appropriate as opposed to the natural, the usual bluegrass mixes that you get. On the other side of the trail, there's the trail. So on the far side of the trail, we have a very narrow kind of mown edge of that, those fescues. And then beyond that is the area of existing buffer plantings between the site and the water. Those buffer plantings are a mixed bag. There are, there's sumac, there's some autumn olive in there. There's a lot of Norway maple. There's other things in there. And the idea is to go in there and selectively remove the invasives. And then where the soils are disturbed, come back in with a conservation mix, seed mix that has both grasses and wildflowers in it. All native, of course. But the question I have for the board, and I've gone back and forth in this in my mind, is there are some mature Norway maples along that buffer are invasive species. Your regulations require the removal of invasive species. However, the Norway maple, even though they are invasive, do create shade, do create habitat. And so I wanted to discuss that with the board. Do you really want to have those, all those Norway maples taken out, or are we going to be, you know, that level of selective and say, no, this has to stay and this has to go? It's something that could go either way. I've had other projects that I've discussed with other towns of whether we leave them or not. And it depends on the quality of the tree. And, you know, there's been some discussion in whether we leave Norway maples or not. The other, let me just change sheets. In your packet, you had L1, which shows the tree planting, and then it shows bubbles, rifts. Since you received that packet, we've further developed the actual shrub planting in those drifts. So you'll be getting that in the next submission. We've got a combination of native and ornamental shrubbery that's pulled against the building and softens the building in big drifts. But on our tree list, we have probably, I wanna say 85% natives and then some ornamentals. The ornamentals are mostly for areas where we're gonna have salt and we want them to stay alive. So we used trees that can stand that salt exposure. And I think for the moment, that's our basis of our presentation. I'll be happy for you to see this enlarged plan yourself and go through the plant material that's in there. And I could do that with you, but I think it's not warranted at this point. But I would enjoy hearing the board's point of view on the Norway maple situation, because I think it's good to have that buffer along there. Obviously, if we did take them out, the stumps have to be left anyways. But I think the shade that they provide and the cover is a good thing. So that's a question for you all. Are there any questions?
Any questions from the commissioners? Allison.
So how are you planning on stabilizing the bank while you're pulling out the invasives? Or are you just cutting down the invasives? I mean, they'll just grow right back.
It depends on what it is. You know, if there's a bunch of bittersweet in there, we're going to have to grub that out. But of course, there'll be erosion control. We won't be working down on the bank per se, because there are some really good pictures in the wetlands report showing the sort of nature of the bank itself. Will be something be cut, some things will be grubbed, the stumps will remain. And we kind of, it's one of those things where we will know when we're out there. Once all of this development starts, we'll get a better handle on what's in there and how to get it. But most of it will be cut, some of it will be grubbed out, but all of it will have erosion control. We won't be going into the face of the bank to do any disturbance along that bank. It's just to remove those invasives.
With regard to the Norway maple, I feel that, you know, I don't think the commission has ever formulated an actual opinion about it. It is an invasive species. Yep. But the thing is that if you've got a tree that's healthy and providing a function, especially because we don't want any more erosion on that bank. And
right.
I think that personally, I think we should leave them. I'm not saying all of them. I'm saying being selective about what's taken out of there.
That's kind of my point of view, but I know not everyone agrees with that. So I wanted to hear what everyone thought.
Samantha.
I just want to say, I agree with Allison on that point.
Yeah, I do too.
I would also.
Right. That's, I'm glad you all say that because I that's the way I feel, but I just wanted to make sure.
And Peter, you can straighten me out a little bit on this, but our regulations don't require that they remove invasive species, right?
I was wondering if anybody else heard that. Well, that, it's not required, but it's allowed. So, yeah.
Robbie, you're looking doubtful.
No, I'm glad that's the case, but it is something that needs to be done. So,
yeah,
I'd like to be wrong in that way.
Yeah, and I guess the only thing I add is the grubbing. I think it would be good to know where, because that would be good to include in the permit specifically, where you're going to do that kind of work, and the state wetland permit too. They're probably going to want to know that.
I think the only thing that would need grubbing is bittersweet if it's there. I don't remember seeing a lot of it, and I was surprised that I didn't see a lot of it. The other thing that we don't have much of is knotweed, which I was grateful for.
Awesome.
So lots and lots and lots of autumn olive. There's a lot of other stuff in there, but.
Well, as far as I'm concerned, the bittersweet needs to come out.
Yeah. And you can't cut that. It doesn't do any good. You got to get it out of there.
Yes.
Samantha?
This just might be my ignorance, but what is grubbing? What's that technique?
It's just using a bucket to scrabble out the roots, the top layer of the roots. And it isn't that much, but it you got to disturb the soil to do it. And that's the key.
Gotcha. Thank you.
So I guess I would interpret that you're mechanically removing these, not removing these by hand.
Correct.
I did have another question too. I had read in the plans that you guys are not doing the sidewalk per se, but there's vegetation or lawn up beyond. There's a lot, I think one of the plans, and maybe it's this one, had a line where how far the lawn goes from the sidewalk to towards the buffer, towards the water.
Just like a 3 or 4 foot shoulder.
So is that going to be vegetated with the same type of grass seed, the fescue that you mentioned?
It's going to be the fescue seed. Yeah, the fescue mix. So anywhere where you see the word lawn, and just on this side of the path is the fescue mix. And then once you leave that, then we're going to go into the conservation mix, which has little blue stem in it. It's got, I believe it has some perennial rye. Hold on a second, I have it here. Creeping red fescue, wild rye, little blue stem, big blue stem, and then it goes on panicum, switchgrass. There's a whole bunch of other things in it, but there's grasses and then there's flower, meadow flowers. And I believe, hold on a second, I just want to go back to the other plan. Yeah, that seeded area right in here between the existing vegetation and the edge of the path. We've got a note on here about the potentially mowing it twice a year in order to knock down any invasives that might come up.
I'm sorry, Robbie, between where? Which one?
So we've got the pathway here, we've got the shoulder here, and then you'll have a little bit of area, and this isn't precise as to where the trees are and the denser vegetation is, but where we've planted that conservation mix, we've got a note in here about potentially mowing it twice a year to keep down invasives and let the natives do their thing.
And is there any possibility of having the conservation mix come up to the sidewalk rather than have a lawn area or grassy area between?
We just thought it would look tidier to have just that little bit of collar at the edge of the walkway, but certainly we could get rid of that if you wanted that.
Yeah, I mean, we're talking about the buffer and trying to preserve as much as possible of it. I think that tidy would not be our priority at this point. It would a more natural looking type of vegetation would be much better.
And the fescues, you know, they get max 20 inches, so they would be, you know, be fine for that.
Thanks. And I have one more question regarding that. Is there fencing going to be there along the sidewalk or?
No. And why do you ask that?
For people walking their dogs and, you know.
Oh, yeah. Okay. That's an interesting thing because have you been to like Wagon Hill Farm in Dover or Durham? That's a place where people really walk their dogs a lot. And they ended up putting in fencing for a number of reasons to keep people away from the edge. And they just used a rustic cedar two rail fence to do that. We had not considered that here. And I wouldn't do it I wouldn't want you to suggest it as a order of approval on this. I would wait to see how things develop because sometimes it happens where that is needed. I don't know that it will be needed here because it's kind of hard to get down to the water. If it was easier to get down to the water, then I would think that that might be something you want to do. But it will be city land as well. So
right.
Easement.
Yeah. Other questions from the commissioners? Allison?
I'm not sure this is appropriate for you, but I was just wondering if you could, or if someone could talk about the contaminated soils, what was there and how more contamination or spreading of the contamination that exists is going to be prevented during this process.
Patrick, do you want to address that?
Yeah, I can feel that. Sure, so I touched on this kind of like an overview, I think at the last meeting, but what we did out there is actually, we've done a pretty extensive soils testing program on the site. We performed 10 test pits. We did 4 groundwater wells and between Ty and Bond and prior consultants, there's 23 borings that have been done out there. So, I mean, we've done quite a bit of work to explore the site and understand it. What we found, what we tested for, I guess, first, so from the soil side of it, what we did was I'm taking notes from my environmental scientist, but it was a comprehensive chemical analysis of volatile organic compounds, semi-volatile organic compounds, total petroleum hydrocarbons, polychlorinated biphenyl, and RCRA8 metals in reactivity. And then the same thing in the groundwater samples. We looked at the VOCs, the SVOCs, and dissolved RCR8 metals. And from all that testing, you know, what we found was that, you know, what you're going to see on this site is actually very typical of an urban site, what you would normally see in an urban fill. In fact, we were very pleasantly surprised at how favorable the results were, given the historic use of the rail itself. I know other sites along this rail corridor had been, you know, some recent projects. There was some pretty contaminated stuff. I know, for example, the coal tar down along the other end of the rail trail, the rail down by the garage and whatnot. We didn't find any of that on this site. In fact, in both the soil and the groundwater, what we testing for all those compounds, we didn't find anything that actually had an exceedance for NHDES regulations. So this is what we're seeing out here. Actually, it's an urban fill that we have a lot of experience with. We just did we've done a few projects of this very same project team, done a few projects in the downtown. We just, you know, we did the boardwalk, but we just did the AC hotel. What we're seeing out here is basically the same thing. So we're very familiar with managing the soils, and there will be a soil management plan implemented as part of this during construction. But, you know, we are from a testing standpoint and looking at it, we actually don't have any exceedances out there. I did note at the last meeting, though, there was back in 92, there was a 20,000 gallon tank that had been removed. We did test in that area. And what we found was just a limited petroleum contaminants in the soil. So what we'll be doing is remediating that under a soil management plan in accordance with the DES regulations.
Thank you.
Thanks. Jessica?
I just have a clarification question. Roberta, you mentioned doing a no-mow or mow a couple times a year to help keep down the invasives, and I appreciate the goal of that, but is that within the 25-foot no-mow buffer?
It is. It'll be those areas where we've removed the invasives in that 20 between the walkway and the bank. Yeah.
So, other questions? So I guess Samantha, go.
No, it's okay. I don't have any more questions for Robbie, but I didn't know if we wanted to go back to Patrick's portion of the presentation yet or not.
Sure.
So then, Patrick, could you discuss a little bit more the pathway that looks like it starts kind of at the cul-de-sac and then goes shoreward of all the buildings? What the substrate of that is, what the purpose of, partially it's a greenway, but it looks like 10 feet wide. So are you still using that for fire access?
Yes, so it's still being designed to meet the trail requirements, which is 10 feet wide. We're not proposing at this time to make it any wider than the 10 feet. So it'd be what we're anticipating a paved path with a gravel base. What we will do is if the fire department is really pushing for this 14, we're thinking that we could extend the base material out 2 feet kind of on either side so that there is a gravel base, but up to the path itself is vegetated so that if a truck were to go out there, there would be a base material and you would just kind of have to go in and repair those lawn areas, maybe along the edging, but it would be stable enough to support a vehicle.
And what's the 10-foot requirement? Where does that come from?
Peter, correct me if I'm wrong. Is it in the ordinance or if it, I believe?
You're muted, Peter.
The fire access, are you asking?
The path requirements, the 10-foot.
I think that's just the design specification we're looking for on the path to get pedestrians and bikes.
Yeah, Peter, I mean, what we're doing is matching what had, in terms of the design, what had been presented as part of the city's conceptual plans that you folks have seen for the path and the width.
And if you think about bicycles, you think about two bicycles going one way and two bicycles going in another way, that's why you need that 10 feet.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't realize that was presented in the conceptual plans for the Greenway. I think that's far too wide and I don't like that it's completely paved, but I'll take that up further in discussion portion. One other question, snow storage. I only see two sections for snow storage, unless I'm missing it, but two of them are still within the 100-foot buffer. Is that correct? Can they be moved? Is there another area for snow storage that's outside? It's way down on the, let's say, eastern end of the site.
So yeah, I'm getting the plan in front of me. Sure. So we've located it there and graded the site such that it would melt onto the.
Want to share that screen, it might be helpful.
Yeah, sure. Sorry. So So Sam, I think you're talking about down here.
Yeah, and the little blob just to the left of it too, I think is also snow storage, but I'm not sure.
This one?
No, like right next to it.
Right here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we were identifying areas within, you know, given the constraints of the site, it is tough to store snow outside of it. I guess we could look at maybe delineating it such that it's stored outside of this buffer here. The idea though, the practical idea is that the snow itself would be stored and the grading in a manner that it's melting back onto the pavement and going into the detention system so that it's treated.
Okay.
But if we can look at reconfiguring the snow storage graphically in this area to try and avoid the 100-foot buffer. You'll see we have identified them other places outside of it.
Okay, yep, I see those over there, yep.
Yep, and also, we recognize the constraints of the site as well, right? So we have noted on the plans that, you know, snow management will need to be done by the property manager if snow banks get too high.
Gotcha, okay, thank you.
Thanks, Samantha. I had a follow-up, only I can't find where it is to the snow storage question. You had a winter maintenance kind of information in here, I think, along with other maintenance of some of the BMPs. But for the winter maintenance, you mentioned once the snow will be removed from site once the banks get 6 feet high. Does that sound familiar to Patrick or?
Let me see. I know, so you're talking about, is it the note on the plans? I apologize. I'm looking at our O&M plan.
You don't see anything on that? Where did I read that? That's weird.
I read it too, Barbara. Now I don't know what I thought either.
It's not in on the.
So the O&M plan, Barbara, that you're referring to is, it's in the drainage analysis.
Okay.
I got it. Yep, you're right. There it is. Snow will be hauled legally disposed of when snowbanks exceed 6 feet in height.
So my question is that along the entryway, and is that also the driveway going in where it's right up against the water and there's very little buffer there? I know that originally has been a problem for some of the abutters noticing that that snow ends up in North Mill Pond. And if you are including that as part of that maintenance plan, that snow getting 6 feet high, I don't think it can happen at the beginning of the driveway without it ending up, it's going to end up in the pond first. That's really high. I think they need to take it off site before that happens or confirm that, somehow assure that none of that snow is going to end up in the pond.
Are you referring to the down the existing road? Sorry if I'm...
Yeah, the existing road.
Okay. Sort of jumping around here. Sorry guys, I'm just trying to get to the right plan.
And maybe that's just added to the snow and ice management for standard asphalt and walkways. You add that a caveat in there about 6 feet high or before snow enters North Mill Pond.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, the other thing about that is the road itself is now where it, you know, you can just go, it could sheet flow directly into the pond. This is all going to be curbed and with a sidewalk. So I think plowing is going to have to occur a little differently out here anyway.
Okay.
But yeah, I'm happy to add that notation to the management plan.
I have two other questions. One is with the walkway, if let's say this were to be approved or when it's approved, this is not really conceptually what the walkway is definitely going to be like. So we're not approving anything to do with the walkway, right? Just to clarify.
I think on this portion, you'd be approving that alignment and that width for the walkway. It is, you know, it is a permit. So, and they're showing it as a paved path there. So, I mean, I guess the permit could be changed, but this does fit what our conceptual design on the walkway is as well. But that hasn't gone to design, final design in this area, but that was what was, how it was planned.
With the 100% paved walkway, the whole thing?
Paved or porous pavement was the plan, but it's not, you know, like I said, it's conceptual, so wasn't ready for permitting yet, that, the city's part. But this is what, this shows it paved, and I think the city would either go with porous pavement or regular pavement. I don't think we'd go with stone dust or gravel.
Thank you. The second question was, there was last time some discussion about the 10% slope or something, and that would increase the no cut area. Did we run into an issue with that? Is that true or is that applicable?
I don't think so.
Okay.
If you look at that throughout the whole site, Patrick, it's typically the only place I can imagine that would be on some of the bank areas, but
yeah, there's this is a pretty flat site. You would, the only place you're going to exceed that kind of slope is the bank area, which I think Robbie described. We wouldn't get into the bank itself.
Okay. Other commissioners? I guess the other question I had to do with one of the other commissioners' questions at the last meeting about lighting. Did you supply a lighting panel plan? You did, right?
It's not part of this package. It's still being worked on because, you know, we just got back into this and we got to modify it based on, because we tweaked all the pavement areas and buildings just slightly. And so we are planning to have an updated photometric plan within the next 2 weeks, because we are going to have to resubmit to TAC. I guess just generally looking at what drafts had been produced, you know, we are looking at providing all the lighting out here is going to conform to the city zoning ordinances, and we'll have to review it with TAC, but they're going to be full cutoff fixtures, you know, spaced along the road and kind of in conformance with that's typical city regulations. You know, the lighting here, it's actually the parking lot lighting will all get kind of screened from these buildings, so you're not going to see that. I think what you'll see out here actually will be an improvement from what is out here now, because they will be the cutoff downlit fixtures. We aren't planning on lighting the path at this time, so it's really, you'll have some lighting, you know, in between the buildings, maybe some light security lighting or whatnot along the face of it, but that's the general description of the lighting.
Okay, thank you. Lighting, and then my one other question, which I think I brought up with Mark West, was he said they would, you might do a bird survey out there. I don't know if that was done or if that's kind of like you're just getting back into it. And
you mean Lenny Lord, Barbara?
I'm sorry, Lenny Lord. Yeah, not Mark West. Why would I get them mixed up?
We did not. I guess we would have to, I'd have to go back and look. I don't, but we didn't perform one yet at this point. You're right, Barbara. We did literally just start this back up like 3 days before the submission was due.
Okay. Other questions, comments? You guys have anything else to present at all on this?
I think that's it.
And do we want to look at a motion?
Barbara?
Yeah?
I'm happy to make a motion. I'd like to make a motion to postpone to the December meeting, and if I have a second, I'd like to speak to it.
Thank you, Ted. Anybody else want to make a motion?
I'll second it.
Thank you, Allison. Go ahead, Ted.
Yes, it's the first time I've seen this plan. I'm a new member of the Conservation Commission. I also got an email from Adam Webster today too, and I feel that I'm not ready to approve this plan. I think it's very complex. I've just seen it. I just received the package, you know, over the weekend, and a staff memo just on Monday. And, you know, I'm familiar with the North Mill Pond, and I was very familiar with the 1998 study on the state of the North Mill Pond. It was done by the advocates. At the time, I was a member of Great Bay Coast Watch, and at that time was testing water in Great Bay on a monthly basis for years. And I think there are a lot of things here that I have questions about. Members of the community as well have written us and contacted us and expressed concerns about acting so quickly because they haven't had an opportunity to look at the plans. So I'd like to move that we postpone this until the December 9th meeting.
Can I just jump in real quick with that motion? You know, just for process, should we be hearing public comment before the motions?
Yeah, well, thank you, Patrick. I totally forgot that we had those. So I don't know if I can go take the motion off the table or
sure.
Oh, Samantha?
I just wonder if we want to have discussion amongst ourselves first before the public comments, because I feel like we're going to discuss a lot of stuff that they're going to bring up, and I don't know if it would save some time or you just want to continue the discussion before removing the motion. I'm not sure what is the best.
Yeah.
Because I know they're going to, I feel like the public comment is going to want us to discuss certain things, which I think we are going to. It's just in what order.
Right. And then we can't have public comment after that, Peter.
I'd just jump in that if you want to change what you're doing, that you should, the person who made the motion would need to withdraw it along with the second, and then you could continue. You could close to the applicant and take public comment and then take a motion after the public comment. That's, you know, I would say.
I'm happy to remove my motion, take an act to remove it.
And then we can still have discussion.
Typically, you have the public comment, then you have discussion. It's not a public hearing, so you have a little more flexibility here. It's not typical. You don't have a public hearing at the Conservation Commission, so it's really your take on the public input. And if you think it'll be more beneficial to do it after, I don't see why that would be a problem. I think once you make a motion, that's when the public comment and the outside comment you probably need to stop. But that's my two cents on it.
Once we make a notion, the outside comment stops. Is that what you said?
I think, yeah, for sure.
And can I wish Marianne was here. Can we have a discussion? Because I agree with Samantha. I think we're going to have a discussion that's going to help with some of the public comment.
If you plan on taking public comment, I think having a discussion and then taking public comment and then asking for a motion makes sense.
Okay. All right. Let's do that then. So Ted, you have withdrawn your motion and second withdraw too?
Yes. Okay. However right. That works.
The motion, what to do a roll call vote on that or just take it off? Take it off.
Good.
Okay. So we'll have discussion then, I guess. Kind of. Samantha, did you wanna? Put you on the spot.
Sure. I feel like I'm kind of saying some of the same things I said at the last time this was presented in front of us, which is just still concerning the 100-foot buffer. And I know they brought back building B to make it flush with, I guess that's building C, the one that is staying in the same footprint. But there's still a good chunk of it that's in the 100-foot buffer, and we have a 100-foot buffer for a reason, and we have, you know, we have 100 feet and not just 50 feet for a reason. And so I would like to see a lot more still come out of the 100-foot buffer on building B and also on building A, And I know that'll reduce the number of units, which then should ultimately, I think, reduce parking, which also would be a good thing on this site. And my other issue is with the pathway. I'm not sure it should be part of this application at all. I mean, if it's a city project, I would like it to remain kind of in the city's hands with that whole conceptual design. And I mean, I don't really recall it being completely paved and 10 feet wide when it was, portions of it were originally discussed with us, but I mean, I might've missed it, but I don't think it should be that way. And I don't think it should be a part of this particular project for the approval.
Okay, thank you. Ted, did you have your hand up too, or?
No.
Anyone else? No. Oops, sorry, we're both at the same time. Allison.
Yeah, no, I agree with Sam. I do appreciate what they have done. I like the fact that they've included sort of a park-like area at that one point. I'm not sure whether the walkway is part of the drive that's necessary for the fire truck. And so having it 10 feet wide instead of 14 feet wide to me is appealing. And just having the base material put in so that the truck could be supported while it's going over that area, I understand. But I do agree that having a 10 foot wide path, it just, you know, I don't think that you need to have two bicycles going in opposite directions next to one another on a path that's in a critical area like this. I'm sure that there are some more wide open spaces where we could incorporate a 10 foot path, but I don't think this is one of them. Unless it has that double function of being, it's unclear to me whether it's also going to be used by the fire truck to get back and forth.
That is part of what we've been doing at TAC to appease the fire department is offering that could be provided as fire access so that they could get to the back of the building.
Okay. Thanks. Samantha? Oh, sorry. I gotta go back to Jess.
Yeah, go to Jess.
Yes. Sorry, Jess. Go ahead.
That's okay. Honestly, I more just want to reiterate a lot of what Samantha and Allison have already said. I appreciate the efforts. I appreciate the things that they've changed to help improve their impact on the site. But I would like to see some further improvement. It feels like too much in this space. And too much on the pond. Beyond the concerns that Sam and Allison already mentioned, I also have concerns about the lighting and not knowing what that's going to look like, and even just the lighting from the three buildings on the impact on the pond. So I still have concerns about the proposal as it is as well.
Thank you. And Samantha.
Just going back to the fire access, I really don't think that this greenway path being so close to the water should be used as fire access. If they need fire access, if that's required, that's fine. But I think it needs to be put in farther away from the buffer, which I do understand means the buildings need to be pulled farther away from the buffer. But I just don't think that the requirements that are necessary for the greenway in order for it to be fire access makes sense, I'm not sure the phrase I'm looking for here, but it's in such a critical area. And the fact that we're putting in a greenway and a pathway, I think is great from a public standpoint, but like we have to be very, very careful about what we do in that area. And I'm it's not sitting well with me that they're now using it for fire access when that should be done. I'm talking in circles, but I just don't think it should be used for fire access.
Thank you. Yeah, and I mean, I have some comments I can make afterwards too, just about more information, but I appreciate the moving back the buildings too and coming. And getting a little more information about the buffers, I still think we need more information on that. And on the invasive species removal, I think I know that they applicants don't really know what's going to happen in the future as far as once they get out there, but I think there's an opportunity to get out there now and give us that information, because we've been burned a lot on this. Not in this particular development yet, but in past situations we have, without having enough information about what's going to be removed and how it's going to be removed and how it's going to be replaced and how it's going to be maintained afterwards. So that would be a big one for me in general. So I'm thinking at this point, we might as well add to the bombardment from getting more information from the public. If there are people that want to speak to this, there were the comments that were submitted. Ted.
I have a question for Patrick. I'm certain this must have come up in your design discussions. What was the alternative for fire access if not this proposed route?
Well, it's kind of worked its way to that. I mean, our position was we felt that we had appropriate access to the buildings, but the fire department really wanted to have 360 degree access. So as you know, we where you could get in, access this building here, pull in, access through here, you know, with the fire lane here, we felt that we covered what would be required of. So, but at TAC, you know, we're trying to balance this. We're getting all the pushback from the fire department that they would like to have the ability, you know, they don't want to have to go back there if they don't have to, certainly. But the thought was just that, you know, we would build it such that if they did need to get back there for some sort of emergency, that it was designed in that manner. And I guess to that point, it really is the site is pretty constrained. Ted, I know you didn't have you weren't at the last meeting. So I guess what I want to show real quick, just to kind of see if I can get it up on my screen. Is a constraints exhibit that we built, because the existing conditions out here is what's really kind of driving the area that we have to work with. Let me see, I'll share it again. So this is the existing site itself. You know, we're dealing with obviously the North Mill Pond to the north, but also what we have is, you know, we have view corridors that are really hindering where we have the ability to locate buildings and pavement. And we also have this large sewer easement that comes through the property. This is a large sewer main that is a major collector of the city down in the West End, and actually goes all the way down to the Deer Street pump station. So we're working in this little pocket basically. And, you know, we've located the pavement on top of the sewer so that it have the ability to access it, but we can't put the buildings here. So that's what we have, this little area here to work with in terms of locating buildings, staying out of view corridors. And, you know, that's what this process has been. You know, we started back to the beginning of my presentation with much larger buildings that literally hugged along the edge of the water. And the reason for that, again, was the constraints. We were trying to push it away from the utilities and everything that exists out here. So it's been a process through the, you know, this past year, we're trying to work within our parameters of the site and trying to meet the needs of you know, being environmentally sensitive, but also providing emergency access. So that's why it is designed the way it is.
Thanks, Roger. Thanks, Ted. Samantha?
I just find it interesting that on your constraints plan, you don't show the 100-foot wetland buffer as a constraint, which I think it is. And I mean, that's why you're in front of us trying to get a CUP.
It is a constraint, there's no doubt. And we're trying to, within reason, do what we can, but you gotta remember what this site really is right now. It's a derelict site, it's not maintained. Anything, you know, I don't have to bring the exhibit up again, but we really are. We're pulling everything back we're improving the buffer impact in every category. We pulled the buildings back. I mean, we have less building in the buffer now than we had before. We have less pavement in the buffer now than we had before. We're going to be removing invasives along the water's edge. But you know, this is it's an urban site. It's pre-developed. Dating way back, this was a rail yard at one point. So we're trying to, this isn't like a blank slate where if the 100 foot existed, we wouldn't be working in there. This is, you know, we're trying to improve what's out here. Otherwise this is the state that you have, which, you know, what I think we're trying to propose is a significant improvement from the existing condition.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. I do feel like though, just in response to that's kind of challenging to think about, because it seems like it's not a great site and it's a derelict site, but it's been trying to recover for many years. And I think you've got a nice, a buffer in between. So it's not native species, it's not great soils, but we are creating a nice screen for wildlife and habitat. And it just seems like there's some good things that are going on right now there. It's not perfect, but. So do we wanna provide an opportunity for the public to comment on this, even though it's not a public meeting or a public hearing? Received for the last three times that you guys have been here, we've been receiving public comments each time. All of them were kind of consolidated for us to look at for this meeting. So we've seen recently the old ones and the new ones from everybody, but we heard comments at a previous meeting. So just to open it up to people so that they could maybe add to any of that they've already presented to us. Not to really necessarily reiterate what they've said before and try to be brief. There's anybody that wants to speak to this?
Allison, the best way to do that is for the attendees to raise their hand and then they can be invited to speak. And if they're on a cell phone, they can push *9, or if they're on the computer, there's a raise hand function either at the bottom or the top of your screen.
Okay, and am I going to see that?
we have one person with a hand raised.
If you okay.
Want to, I can
call on.
Anyone can help with that too, but I think I can do that. At least Elizabeth Hewitt, I'm not allowed to talk first. Can you hear me, Elizabeth?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, perfect. My name is Liza Hewitt. 167 169 McDonough Street. I'd like to review the reasons why Portsmouth has a wetlands protection ordinance in the first place. The following reasons are taken verbatim from the purpose section of the wetlands protection ordinance. Number one, to maintain and where possible, improve the quality of surface waters and groundwater by controlling the rate and volume of stormwater runoff and preserving the ability of wetlands to filter pollution, trap sediment, retain and absorb chemicals and nutrients and produce oxygen. Number two, to protect and where possible, improve wildlife habitats and maintain ecological balance. Number three, to protect and where possible, improve unique or unusual natural areas and rare and endangered plant and animal species. Number four, to protect and where possible, improve shellfish and fisheries. And number five, to require the use of best management practices and low impact development in and adjacent to wetland areas. This project easily fails each of the six criteria needed to grant CUP as outlined in Article 10, Section 10.1017.50 as described. The first criteria, the land is reasonably suited to the use, activity, or alteration. I would say the land inside the 100-foot buffer is suited for wildlife habitat and the protection of the flora and fauna that call North Mill Pond home. It is not suited to be destroyed by development. Number two, there is no alternative location outside the wetland buffer that is feasible and reasonable for the proposed use, activity, or alteration. I would say There's plenty of room outside the 100-foot wetland buffer to construct this project, acres, in fact. There is absolutely no reason this entire project cannot be constructed upland of the 100-foot wetlands buffer. Number three, there will be no adverse impact on the wetland function values of the site or surrounding properties. I would say there will be a massive adverse impact to wetland functional values, ranging from habitat destruction to huge increases in stormwater runoff. Number four, alteration of the natural vegetative state or managed woodland will occur only to the extent necessary to achieve construction goals. I would say this project's construction goals can easily be achieved by building the entire project upland of the 100-foot wetlands buffer. No need to alter the natural vegetative state at all. Number five, the proposal is the alternative with the least adverse impact to areas and environments under the jurisdiction of this section. I would say the proposal with the least adverse wetlands impacts has not been presented. This project does not need a CUP because it can be constructed entirely outside the 100-foot wetlands buffer. Number six, any area within the vegetation buffer strip will be returned to a natural state to the extent feasible. I would say, since there is no reason this project needs to be constructed inside the 100-foot buffer, the existing vegetation does not need to be disturbed and therefore no restoration required. I would also like to note the applicant has not applied for the New Hampshire DES for a Shoreland Protection Act permit or for wetlands permit. If they had, the Conservation Commission would know the results of the New Hampshire Division of Forest and Lands Natural Heritage Bureau inventory of rare and endangered species in the North Mill Pond area. This is another reason to reject this request. I thank you for your consideration of these reasons to not recommend a CUP for this project. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Liz. Was there anybody else, Peter?
There is, it's Elizabeth Bratter. I'll allow her to talk.
Okay.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, good. My name is Elizabeth Bratter, property owner of 159 McDonough Street. Just a few weeks ago, this commission was discussing in detail very careful placement of a fish statue and benches in the McEachran Park, which is within the 100-foot wetland buffer. Today, we are discussing whether to allow more than 10,000 square feet of building, the replacement of hundreds of trees with 38 in this particular area, the removal of natural stormwater filtration with pipe systems, the addition of a very large grade to accommodate the underground parking, and a complete negation of the functional value of an ecosystem in that same 100-foot wetland buffer. Article 10 states that the North Mill Pond is a wetland, which does not allow the erection or construction or impervious surface in the 100-foot wetland buffer. Section 10.10.18.10 regarding stormwater management states best practices per New Hampshire DES should be used, which include allowing stormwater to infiltrate the ground as much as possible, locating the structures away from the water source, projects be designed to avoid and minimize impact to the wetlands and other jurisdictional areas. The impacts proposed must only be those that are avoidable and to maintain or restore the natural vegetative areas of the buffer. So I too, like Liza, went through the list and did all six, but I'm not gonna do them all because of what you talked about, because your discussion did include some of the stuff. I just wanted to talk about the alteration, number four and number five. The alteration of natural vegetative state and managed woodland would occur only to the extent necessary. To build this large project so close to the water's edge will require large trucks, which will need 20 feet of space just to stand still, much less cranes and staging areas. A dilapidated forest, where the two walls of the 100-year-old roundhouse still stand, the inland wetland where the once ancient turnstile was, the 3,200 square foot building that has gravel that has not had any added to it, but it now has saplings and plantings there. And it's all surrounded by trees and shrubs that'll all be bulldozed to be replaced by 15 to 20 feet of grade, over 32,000 square feet of impervious surface, about 33 trees in that area, lots of grass, and a rain garden with a 240-foot long drainage pipe. The area from the 50 to 100 foot wetland buffer should be restored by this development. They should move out of it and restore it, especially the large proposed grass area that's on the hill on the backside of buildings A and B. That could be covered with trees and shrubs and the conservation mix, which Robbie suggested. Number five is the proposal is an alternative to the least adverse impact to the area environments under the jurisdictional section. Like a child, developers seem to ask for the moon first, and sometimes someone might say yes. However, this development has not been presented with the least adverse impacts. If the rule was a sidewalk should be included in a development and there was room, would it be expected? Yes. This development has been hedging on following the no impervious surface in the 100-foot wetland buffer. The adverse impacts of this to this highly delicate area of the North Mill Pond will likely suffer from the large quantities of fresh water being added to it, the wildlife losing their nesting, winter protections, and abundant food sources, and the large standing structures within the 100-foot wetland buffer, which would move human activity further into the 50-foot buffer. This lack of protection of the 100-foot buffer for years of The least adverse impacts to this area have not yet been presented and should be asked for, and thank you for doing so. And there is a lot of land left to develop along this pond, which is also in the 100-foot buffer, which needs to be protected. And I'm sorry I can't comment on the information presented regarding the road because I didn't have time to really look at that carefully. I would like to ask that you do not allow this to move forward. Please save the North Mill Pond from these egregious insults. Use the rules and regulations that are available to you. Ask them to move out of the 100-foot buffer. Ask them to review their stormwater proposals and include more natural infiltration techniques provided in the best practices recommended in 10-10-18-10. Ask them to restore the dilapidated forest of the thick thicket and the shrub thicket with a new forest and shrubs for wildlife and humans alike to enjoy within the 50 to 100 foot wetland buffer as recommended in 10-10-1750. The city of Portsmouth does not need another grass field parked with evenly spaced trees where once a small forest stood. And please ask them, which you did do, to clarify the restoration back to the natural thing. Thank you for your time. And I agree with everything that you recommended.
Thank you, Liz. Are there any others, Peter?
I don't see any other hands raised right now.
Peter, can I ask one quick question? You had mentioned this wasn't a public hearing. I'm just a little confused about that because we're continued from our CUP application last June. I just wanted to confirm that.
Conservation Commission doesn't do a public hearing. It's at the planning board. So the public notice and the abutter notices all go out based on the planning board CUP application. The Conservation Commission's advisory, and they have a choice, or they're allowed to not take public comment, but they typically do, just to round out the discussion.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks for the clarification.
Sure.
Thanks, Peter.
So I don't see any other hands raised at this time.
Okay. So do we have any more comments or questions from the commissioners? Do we want to go back to our motion? Anybody want to make a motion? Ted?
I'll make the motion once again to postpone the meeting until December 9th. Postpone this particular application until December 9th.
Thank you, Ted. Seconded?
I'll second it.
Allison, thank you. Any more discussion? Ted?
And once again, there is a tremendous amount of information here. I don't feel that I'm qualified to vote tonight. I really want to take a look at this information. I'd like to go back and review the plan from 1998 as well. There was some real some visioning that was set out in that plan about what the public was anticipating and hoping for in the future. I'd just like to go back, take a look at it, and I'd interested in taking a look at some of the detailed information about as well about some of the testing that's been done for what's in the ground and what's currently there.
Okay. Anybody else? Allison?
I think personally that it's good to hear the public comment. It sort of reinforces the feelings that we have expressed here at the Conservation Commission. And I think having an extra month may help to bring some sanity to the proposal.
Thank you, Allison. So, and Samantha.
Yeah, I'm fine with postponing it. You know, from the last meeting where this came up and we postponed to this meeting. You know, my comments are still the same. I would still like to see stuff moved out of the 100-foot buffer. That's always been my biggest issue, but I'm fine postponing.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, and I think we commented earlier, really during that discussion phase, on other things that we'd be looking for too. So, which was what we would usually do during the discussion. I'd like to do a vote, roll call. Jess?
Yes.
Samantha?
Yes.
Allison?
Yes.
Ted? Yes. And the chair votes yes. The motion is postponed. Thank you, you guys.
Thank you for your time. We'll see you next month.
Okay. I think our next item on the agenda is other business, only I don't have the agenda in front of me anymore.
I have it. I didn't have anything in other business section at this time. But that is other business and adjournment are the only two other items on the agenda.
Okay. I don't know what happened to it. I think I had no. Oh. Anybody else have other business? Peter doesn't have any? No? Okay.
Barbara?
Yes, Ted.
I'd just like to forward a discussion that I had with our other member of the board that couldn't be here tonight because of a death in the family. But Adam Webster sort of expressed the same thing that I did, that, you know, I had a brief 4 months on the Conservation Commission back in 2018, and I learned some things, but I didn't learn enough. So I know I'm trying to educate myself. I'm going to go to the conference this weekend and, you know, and try to see what I can't learn. But Adam expressed sort of an interest that maybe we could have a work session sometime and talk about how do we view the role of the Conservation Commission? You know, what is our authority? You know, what can and we cannot do? You know, I can study the regulations, but I'm interested in learning more, that's all. And he also expressed that. So maybe sometime, maybe December or January, we could, you know, have a discussion amongst us, amongst the commission members about, I guess, philosophy about our goals and objectives as a commission. I know we're a regulatory board and we have responsibilities within that context. There's no doubt about it. And that's mostly what we are, you know. But I just wanted to have a broader discussion about it. I know, for instance, there was a resolution that was passed by the City Council in 2017 that tasked the Conservation Commission to come up with an education program to teach citizens of Portsmouth and property owners how to follow organic land management practices. I don't believe that's ever been addressed as an example. And I'd love to have some sort of either a work session or a section of the meeting where we could spend about 20 minutes and share ideas in that regard.
Okay. Allison?
I just want to comment that it's very difficult to have a conversation because we can't have a conversation amongst ourselves. It's always got to be a public, it's mm-hmm. got to be publicly announced, and we have whoever wants to attend the meeting is able to attend the meeting. And so that makes it a little more difficult. Regarding educating the public, we have actually educated the public in that we have sent out flyers a couple of times to people that have wetlands on their property. And we explained to them how to care for the wetlands and what's allowed and what's not allowed. There's also educational material in the Conservation Commission office. And certainly, as you know, if you wanted to make arrangements, as I said, to come over and I can show you what are some of the typical invasive species in the area and what are some typical native plants are in the area, I'll be glad to show you anytime.
Terrific. Thank you.
Yeah, I was going to add to Ted, they had you are going to the on Saturday. Are you attending the conservation?
Yes.
Because I know they have one session on that too, just sort of broad, you know, what our responsibilities are.
I'm signed up.
Yeah, that's great. So I don't know how the other, I mean, do we want to spend 20 minutes on an agenda item at some point, maybe in January or something, if things calm down, just to discuss any questions that you have and discuss it a little further? I mean, Allison is addressing some of those things, but. Do the other commissioners want to do that or?
Yeah, and what I said doesn't just go for Ted. I mean, if anybody wants to ever look at plant materials, I've got a yard filled with them. So you can come and look and you can come and, you know, I have wetland on my property and you can see what we've done over the years to help preserve it. And
yeah. Yeah, Ted, and if you want to come up with a little more specifics on some questions and stuff, we can talk about it ahead of time to put an agenda, to put it on an agenda.
Sure. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thanks, Allison. Ted, Samantha?
I don't know if we can kind of also add to that discussion kind of like future roles of the Conservation Commission, like where do we kind of want to head as a city board? Because I know we talk after certain projects kind of come through of, you know, what we want to add to the ordinance, you know, for further protections. I don't know if that we want to add that to part of that discussion or if that's.
Something that I've brought up several times is that we need to look to see what properties are available for development in Portsmouth, and maybe we can purchase them. Maybe we can do some fundraising, you know, anything like that. But we don't have to build on every single piece of property in the city of Portsmouth. And we have no way of not having the owners of those pieces of property do whatever they want with them within the guidelines of the ordinances. So, you know, if we can be proactive and look at some areas that we could protect before the developers get in there. You know, I mean, I think we can anticipate that and that we should consider moving forward. I mean, we have this conservation fund that has money in it. And yes, it is growing because it's sitting there. But the thing is that, you know, I see the city taking little bits of it because they have a piece of property that they want to do something with. And it's not necessarily the most pristine wetland area or whatever, but for some reason we need to donate our money to that. And I would like to take a nice pristine wetland area with an upland area and protect that now before a developer gets in there and puts, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars into the engineering of a piece of property. So I think that that's something that we should really seriously consider.
Yep.
Yeah, kind of comes out today with this piece of property, sort of like.
Yeah, and Zero Banfield Avenue.
Yeah, that's one, yeah. It's like opportunities to get ahead of it.
Right.
So we'll put that on the agenda for when we have a lighter load, maybe hopefully in January.
Yeah, that'd be great if we ever have a lighter load. I mean, like if this is coming back in December, it's not going to be a very light load again, but.
Yeah. I mean, I can provide you guys with maps. We've gone over this. We have our pool of study. There's projects right there you can pull out and say, let's buy this or start a campaign. There's properties that are adjacent to our pool of properties. It's, you know, it's really about what you want to target and what we could actually do. I think the developers might be one step ahead in there. Certainly in the money. I mean, the Stokel property is the next one coming in, and that's been up for sale for years, but his asking price was, I think, in the above 5 million, maybe 10 million. So the developers have to build all these houses to make their money back. Zero Banfield, I struggle with it because, you know, we started with a strong recommendation against it, and then it still ended up getting developed, but we didn't hear from the public on it. So why wasn't there the outcry when you have a pristine piece that hasn't been developed like that, yet there's this downtown piece that's in an urban area that's in some ways blighted, that they're, everybody's coming out in force? Well, we know why that is, I think. And so it's frustrating on some level, but I'm certainly encouraged by the, if you want to be proactive about protecting properties, we do have a conservation fund. We did protect that nice property on Banfield. It was part of a mitigation property project, but that is a pretty pristine piece. It doesn't have the upland that you're talking about, but if we have an upland with access to it, there's very few and far between in the city that the developers haven't capitalized on. Right. And, you know, unfortunately, it typically seems like we see them after the developer comes in and it's too late to buy it, and we wouldn't be able to pay what they paid or are gonna pay for it if they get the development rights. But certainly we can look at that. We can look at that, and I guess what we need to come up with is a process. We have, you know, all the data we need at our fingertips with GIS. We could get together, probably even, you know, using Zoom, look at some properties and figure out the values and write letters to the owners and, you know, make offers or, you know, talk to the city council. Really, they have to be involved because, well, the conservation fund is partly the Conservation Commission's responsibility, it takes the city council to authorize it. So we could recommend an acquisition, but the council would have to approve it. But if we come up with a good project, I don't see why they wouldn't. And we, you know, Banfield Road's gonna be putting money into the fund, and if the Stokels get developed, then they'll be putting money into the fund, so.
Well, personally, I've mentioned several times is that property behind St. Catherine's Church that was, the other side of the pond, basically, from where the people had done that nice clear cutting on the other side of the pond there. So St. Catherine's has a parking lot that's never filled. It's got that huge piece of property back there. If we approached the Catholic Church and said, the city of Portsmouth would like to acquire that land from you so that it can't be built on, I think that would be a great start.
Yeah, I mean, that's a really good use of funds too. Putting easements on properties aren't necessarily as expensive as getting the fee for it. And the church might be up for that.
Another one might be, this is right by me, but the Chase Home property. Mm-hmm. Back.
Oh,
there.
I'm hoping that's never built. It's right by me too. Yeah. Absolutely. Well, you know what I do? I actually support the Chase Home. I donate to them every year, hoping that it will allay any thought of.
Yeah, that's one way to do it. Yeah.
Yeah. Or do a conservation easement too.
Yeah. They can put an easement somebody on the back of that property.
Yeah. So this seems like we got to do a little follow up. Yeah. We can talk more and figure out how to.
Yeah. Let me know if you have properties you want me to look into. I can look into those two for sure.
And give okay, you- good.
That'd be awesome.
And if you have other ones, just send me an email and I can get you the details on it.
Thank you.
Okay. And then we can talk about next steps.
Yeah.
Okay.
Whether you want to create a process or take it, you know, ad hoc approach and target one property at a time. I don't know, you know, what the city council's interest in it would be, but there is a conservation fund, you know, there's also conservation land that we have that we could do more with, whether it's conservation values or public access or, you know, invasive species removal, that kind of thing. So I, you know, leave it to you guys to sort of lead the charge. There's not a ton of capacity at the staff level, unfortunately, but I certainly can help at least get the data out there and the information and
Well, it'll be nice to get some new blood on the Conservation Commission, just because, you know, I'm 67 years old and there's only so much I can do physically anymore. I can barely take care of my own yard, but I, you know, when we do go into some of these areas, I am cutting bittersweet.
Yeah.
Well, we have underutilized resources too, which Peter has sort of alluded to. The Great Bog is a terrific resource. And that was a perfect example of the city pooling resources together to save 300 acres from development, you know. So that's one example. And I've been out there recently, actually, and it's just not utilized enough. Even though you see a lot of people out hiking now, I just haven't seen enough folks out there.
Yeah, it seems like throughout the city. I went out to the bog recently, too, with the Southeast Land Trust for the conservation monitoring, and the trails that are out there are all overgrown. I get, you know, every couple of years when I get either Liberty Mutual or UNH or somebody or the crew, I get them to go out there and keep the trail clear. But it seems like I'm doing it for not a lot of users, unfortunately. I don't know why, but it is a great spot in the city to go walk. And, you know, you probably got a mile, more than a mile worth of trails at least.
Yeah, it seems like right now, everybody.
I think that the parks in the residential area are the ones that are more highly valued by our residents than those on the outskirts. I think that's why the Great Bog is underutilized.
That's true. That's a good example is the Little Harbor Road Trail.
Yeah.
That gets a ton of use.
Yeah, especially now. It's like, okay. Well, we got definitely some more discussion to talk about on this, like three different options really to look at. So, all right. So you guys want to send some recommendations? Okay, go ahead. To Peter.
I thought you were looking for a motion for adjournment.
Allison.
You can declare the meeting adjourned, Barbara. There's no need to take a vote.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Who was the second?
Second.
Ted, Allison, Jessica. Okay, we're going to adjourn.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, you guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.